Buenos dias. Thank you. Welcome to the world premiere of the film Faith in Blackness, an Exploration. Yeah, let's give it a round of applause. The film Faith in Blackness, an Exploration of Afro-Latina Spirituality. My name is Natalie Amador Solis. I am the Latinx Curatorial Assistant for the Smithsonian Folklife Festival program, Creative Encounters, Living Religions in the U.S., taking place now until July 9th at the National Mall. This event is being co-presented by the Center for the Study of African American Religious Life at the Smithsonian's Museum of African American History and Culture. Creative Religions, Creative Encounters, Living Religions in the U.S. has received generous support from the Lilly Endowment's Religion and Curatorial Institutions Initiative. The national initiative aims to help museums and other cultural institutions foster greater public understanding about religion and present the contributions of people of all faiths and diverse religious communities. This program also received federal support from the Latino Initiatives Pool, administered by the National Museum of the American Latino. Thank you all for attending today, and I invite you to visit the Smithsonian Folklife Festival to explore the rituals and values that shape American cultural traditions and help us organize our lives. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Erica Galt, and I have the pleasure of serving as the director for the Center for the Study of African American Religious Life. Thanks to the generous support of the Lilly Endowment, over the past 7 years, the center has offered innovative Black religious scholarship, award-winning public programs, and dynamic collecting of religious artifacts. Our mission always is to help extend the ways the global public and our nation's foremost research and cultural institutions acknowledge and explore religion. Through this film, Afro-Latin Theology Project and the Afro-Latin Forum forwards that mission and exploring the rich cultural heritage of Afro-Latin religions. And we are pleased to welcome you here in person in our virtual audience here today for the world premiere of Faith in Blackness, an Exploration of Afro-Latin Spirituality. Following the viewing, please remain for a talkback led by the Afro-Latinx curator Dr. Ariana Curtis, and the center's curator for religion, Dr. Teddy Reeves. Again, thank you and welcome, and please enjoy. Good morning again. I know by this point you have now been able to see the documentary and enjoy the rich faith expressions exhibited throughout of Afro-Latin culture. I want to begin now with the talkback and introduce you to some of the faces that you've seen in the documentary, as well introduce our curators, and I'll share with you who will be joining us, their bios. Josue Perea is the producer and writer of the Faith in Blackness film. In addition, he is the executive director of the Afro-Latin Forum, an associate pastor of Metro Hope Church. Yes. Dr. Marisela Gomez has spent more than 20 years engaged in social justice activism, community building, and health research and practice. She is a mindfulness practitioner in the tradition of Thich Nhat Hanh, Order of Interbeing. Yahusef Medina is the Interim Director of Community Initiatives at Virginia Humanities. In his role, he oversees the HBCU Scholars Fellowship and leads the organization-wide internship programs and helps with the strategic development of numerous community efforts. Yolanda Correa is a doctoral candidate in the field of religion and culture at Southern Methodist University. She is also the newly appointed program coordinator for the Hispanic House of Studies at Duke Divinity. Leading us in our discussion is Dr. Ariana Curtis, who is the first curator of Latinx studies at the National Museum of African American History and Culture. Here she leads the research and collections that center Latinidad through an African American lens. She is curator of the award-winning Latinx Collections Portal and has held leadership roles in major Smithsonian-wide initiatives, most recently as director of content for Our Shared Future, Reckoning with Our Racial Past. And last is Dr. Teddy Reeves. He is the Center for the Study of African American Religious Life. curator for religion here at the museum. And he is also the creator and producer of the museum's first feature documentary film, God Talk. We welcome them at this moment. Thank you.
All right, let's jump in. How many of you enjoyed the film? Josue, you did it, brother. You did that, and everyone else that was a part of it. But I want to jump into our talk back and our time together. We're going to open at the end to allow audience questions as well. So as we're going through, get some things formulated in your brain. But tell us about the creative process, the cinematography, the sound, the story construction, the principal decisions. What did you want the audience to walk away with once viewing the film?
Yes, thank you so much, Teddy. Thank you everyone for coming, and thank you all here. What a wonderful time. It's such an honor to be able to premiere the film here at the Oprah Winfrey Theater at the National Museum of African American History and Culture. I'm gonna answer the question, but I do wanna shout out my dear friends and director, producer, editor, Michael Lopez and Charles Reynoso, who are in the audience, who really did a lot of that work. Let's give them a round of applause. And all my dear friends and family, Leonette, my sister, my nephew, everyone here. All right, now back to the question. You know, we got to shout our people.
It wouldn't be right if you didn't shout them out.
We got to shout. And there's so many people that I just can't. It's too many people. But when we, you know, when we started the film, when we started, we really wanted to, it started from a paper that I wrote on Afro-Latinx theologies and how we saw, and Yolanda and I saw in many places, and many of us have seen, but that Black Latinos are not discussing religious and spiritual spaces except if it's like only, if it's isolated to a specific area. And we wanted to show the diversity of faiths. We wanted to show the diversity of perspectives. We also wanted to make sure that it felt healing. one of our biggest parts of the film was that we wanted to celebrate the beauty, strength, and resilience of Blackness in that it was beautiful. And so we made very specific choices on making sure that we did not show any trauma, any Black trauma images. We wanted the images of Blackness to be images of Black beauty, of Black strength, of Black resilience, of kindness, of gentleness, of joy. And so far, that seems to be what people are experiencing from the film. We wanted the cinematography to feel very welcoming, like you're talking with someone in their living room. I mean, literally, we're in a lot of living rooms and homes, so that it feels very, very close. And so that you got to know everyone who was in the story. And we wanted the stories to show that even people who have practiced many different faith traditions have similar ideas of the way that their Blackness has been so integral to their personality and their faith tradition. Because I think sometimes there are people who separate the two and say, you know, oh yeah, you're Black, period, and you're Christian, or you're Black, period, and you're whatever. We're like, for all the faith traditions, their Blackness, it's a part of their livelihood, of how they live in the world. And those were some of the decisions that we wanted to make. And musically, we wanted it to have a very diasporic sound. We wanted it to sound like many different sounds from the diaspora. As I was sharing backstage, getting Las Caras Lindas was such a big, important thing for us, because that song, for those of you who don't speak Spanish, literally the name, the song talks about the beautiful faces of Black people. That's what the song is, Las Caras Lindas, the beautiful faces of Black people. And we were like, we want to show that. And so we want to show the beautiful faces. We want to show, Michael did a really good job in researching and finding archival footage of Black people from the 1930s in Cuba. And we think those are Black Puerto Ricans in Cuba, actually. So it's such a beautiful image. And we wanted to make sure that people walked away with the fact that there have been for a long time people who knew that they were Black, who celebrate their Blackness, and that Blackness is beautiful and that Blackness is strong, regardless of whether we speak Spanish, Portuguese, Creole, English, that Blackness is strong. So that's one of the things we wanted to do.
Wow. Wow. And so I want to kind of go deeper in to a point that you hit on. The film does a beautiful job of showing kind of the pluralistic expressions of faith amongst Afro-Latinx communities. What was the intentionality around that decision, right? Because oftentimes when we're talking about religion, we can situate ourselves in Abrahamic traditions, we can situate ourselves very distinctly in places, but what traditions were you unable to reference or depict, and why?
Yeah, so when the paper that I wrote that started this conversation is only specifically about Christianity, specifically about Protestant Christianity. So we're very specific, it's like a lane. But then when we were, you know, the idea for the film came literally in a game of pool in Brooklyn. Charles, Michael, and I were playing pool, and I was telling them about this paper, and Michael had given a lot of ideas, so he was like, do this, write this. And Charles was like, let's turn this into a movie. This is a movie. I was like, no, it's not. It's a paper. And he was like, well, because then I said, well, it's only Christian. He's like, so let's get people from different traditions. And what we started to do, we were like, all right, let's. So we were like, I grew up Pentecostal. So I was like, Pentecostals are easy. I can get that. No problem. We can get a Catholic, wherever. Okay. But then we were like, let's make sure that we're inclusive of at least as many traditions that show a diversity that is not something that people expect. So we wanted to make sure we had someone who practiced something of a Jewish tradition. We wanted to make sure that we had someone who was Muslim. We wanted to make sure that we had someone who practiced Buddhism, because those are things that people don't recognize but have been a long part of the diaspora and of Afro-Latinx theology and spirituality. So we made a list of just five. I think it was Christianity, Islam, Judaism, Buddhism. And then we said we need something of an African descendant tradition. But, you know, with African descendant traditions, because people don't know them as well, they just lump them all together. There's many different of those types. So it's not only, you know, like the terms, we intentionally don't use the term Santeria in the documentary, because that's not how that community wants to identify itself moving forward. They would like to be known by their individual traditions. There's Lukumi, there's Ifa, there's Palo, there's Candomblé, there's Vudun. So those are the ones that actually we wanted to meet. There's a part where we wanted to, the ones that we included are the ones that you saw there, but the ones that we wanted to do, and if we do a sequel or a follow-up to this specific movie, because we have another idea for something we want to do on Blackness and contemplation, But for that one, we want to capture someone with a candomblé perspective. And I mean, black Muslims in Brazil were really integral to the independence of Brazil as a country. So that's a really interesting story there. Fudun is such an interesting, and it's been so miscategorized in American culture. So Fudun is really important. The African Methodist Episcopal Church has a lot of black Latino people in that congregation. That's a really exclusively black denomination here in this country. So those are three that are like immediately, like we would want to include those. And actually someone from a brujeria perspective, like someone who practices that within a black Latino perspective. But as you know, there's only so many minutes in a film. And we were like, and actually we were like, if we include more voices, no one's gonna get enough time. So we wanted to make sure that everyone had enough time, that everyone was able to get their story out. But there's definitely other traditions that we wanna do, because we have an idea for an international version of this conversation, to go to Haiti, to go to PR, to Jewish communities, black Latino Jewish communities in PR, to Candomblé and Muslim communities in Brazil, and capture all of that, because there's so much there.
Absolutely. It was refreshing. My seminary classmate was in the film, Emilio. So when I saw it, I said, look at my brother.
And Emilio is creating, just real quickly on that, Bishop Emilio is creating a unique denomination that's Christian, Orthodox, but also very Pentecostal, very black. Like, that space was so black. It was so unique. Actually, we've told Emilio, we're like, we need to capture you talking about the creation of that denomination. And that is, and I think that there's something about black folk and ingenuity in creating new traditions, which is a long history of the diaspora and continues to this day. And I think that's a beautiful aspect.
Absolutely, absolutely. I want to broaden this and throw this question to Yolanda, and I open it up to everyone else. This is a conversation about intersectionality as much as it is a conversation about blackness and divinity. What are the intersections present within the film? What are the nuances? What is unspoken? And what are the frameworks needed to enter this sacred conversation?
First of all, thank y'all so much for being here. I'm so excited to see so many familiar faces and so many new faces. I think there's a lot to those questions, and I don't know that I could give like a solid answer to all of them, but I feel like the intersections, some of them are very obvious, right? We have different traditions speaking to each other. We have people who come from different countries in Latin America, or their families come from different countries in Latin America, which I think is really important, because this whole notion of Latinidad, right, as this like pan-ethnic identity that we share, often what it does is erase the realities of what it means to be Colombian versus Puerto Ricano versus Brasilero. And so I think that's one of the intersections that was really important here. It was not only the faith traditions that are represented, but also the people that are represented, where they come from, diaspora people, people from continental Latin America, from the Caribbean. In terms of the nuances and what is missing, I think the film does this thing where it demands something from the audience that is watching it, in the sense of what Josue was saying earlier. Intentionally, there's no images of black trauma. There's no images that speak to that experience, because it assumes that you should know that that is the case, right? And that if you're expecting that to happen, then that is demanding a question from you. Why is that your expectation? Like, why when we talk about blackness, we need to talk about trauma and abuse? Why can't we see joy? Why can't we see, right, as smiles and music and all these things? And so I think there's some things there that nuance the film silently, but that invite you into that conversation. And I think that goes into that last part of the framework. And I struggled a lot with that question, because I think on the one hand, the academic in me is like, oh, you need this framework and that framework, and you need to do this. But the other part of me is like, I think what the film is doing is precisely saying that we don't need specific frameworks, that that is a conversation that we need to have together in community, that you don't need to come from the academy, that you don't even need to belong to a particular denomination of faith tradition, because the film represents persons and the people that they interview that are specifically affiliated to a specific tradition. But there's a lot of Latinos, Latines, that don't affiliate to any sort of tradition, but they still have faith in their practice, right? They still have. So I think that's really important in understanding the film, is that when we talk about religion and when we talk about faith in Latin America, we need to be as expansive as possible, and we also need to drop this idea that we need specific knowledge to be able to be the bearers of knowledge or be the leaders of the conversation. I don't think we need specific frameworks. If you're here, you're here, and we can talk about it.
Thank you. Anyone else want to jump in on that question?
The only thing I would add is that there's, I think, one of the things that the film did really beautifully without explaining it, you know, to the audience, is this intergenerational conversation, I think, is also happening there. And so I appreciated seeing that, and I appreciated the film not being heavy-handed, you know, about that, but just the ways in which we experience any type of realm, the spiritual realm especially, is that it is an intergenerational space, not just in terms of us like naming, you know, Gen Z, millennial, baby boomer, right? But understanding that it's always, you know, ancestors, contemporaries, descendants in this conversation that we're having. And so I really appreciated that as well.
Awesome, awesome. I want to ask each of you if you could touch this question, because I think it is essential to the beginning of the film and really running throughout the film. And so I'll invite you all at whatever pace you want to. I'm going to throw it to Yahusef to start us, and then we can work our way. But what was your first image of the divine?
Thank you.
And where did the image come from, and when did it begin to shift for you?
Yes. And let me preface by saying, in the spirit of this theological discussion, I just want to give all praise to my creator and savior, Yahusha Mashiach, and say hallelujah. But I'm blessed to be here today with you all. It's an honor. To answer your question, you know, as I think back to my childhood, I would say, you know, I grew up in sort of an atypical, a-religious household for a Puerto Rican family. My family was Catholic by default, if you will, but they weren't really practicing, maybe Easter Mass or something like that. I did go to Catholic junior high school, but that was more disciplinary than anything else. You know, but as far as my first interaction with Blackness from, you know, a religious perspective, I do remember my grandmother taking me to Jackson Ave in Queens to the Botanica and seeing, like, you know, these different, you know, santeros and the saints and things like that. And some of them were Black. I do remember seeing that as a young child. But then also, as I mentioned in the film, I was very much informed by what was taking place in my community, by hip hop at the time. And there was a very strong 5% or a Nation of Gods and Earths sort of philosophy that was carrying about. I remember being in elementary school and we were calling each other gods, you know, yo, peace, God. But that we didn't know, you know, the significance or the severity of that at that time. It's when I reflect back and I'm saying, wow, I was already kind of steeped in some of this culture and using the terminology and referring to one another as gods. And, you know, I always saw Blackness, you know, positively affirmed in my home. And so I'm very thankful for that, because my parents never made me feel less than for being a Black Latino, you know, and many of my friends were Afro-Latinos. And so it was just a very rich sort of environment. You know, I did have the intersection with, you know, white Jesus, but that was later on after I already had some developmental experience. That was like in junior high school when I had to go to Mass every morning for the school that I was at, and I would see the stained glass and the, you know, and the images, and but we were, you know, rebellious kids, so we used to take aim at those things, you know. And it got us in trouble at times too. So that was sort of my, you know, upbringing. Then of course, as I mature and I start to get more into my history, you know, I become more informed about sort of these traditions and things like that. And of course, I'm here today. So
I don't know if Marisela wanted to jump in first.
Hello. Can everyone hear me? All right, thank you. Thanks everyone for coming, and thanks everybody up here. It's a pleasure to meet folks and re-meet others. So this question is an interesting question. It has me thinking. I have to say that the word divine, so I grew up in Belize in the Caribbean, Central America. I don't know if I ever heard that word divine there. What I was aware of was spirit. I was aware of church. So by default, I also grew up in a Catholic space. As you know, the colonization in the Caribbean and Central America was much a lot of Catholic. So I attended a lot of Catholic church. My family was very Catholic. I had an aunt that was a Catholic nun. And so I was around a lot of nuns, being bounced around nuns' knees, you know, from when I was very small. I never felt anything around divine, but when I was in church, I felt spirit. I felt a spiritual presence. And so I saw the images, but I never, you know, Jesus and Mary, and I wanted to be a nun when I was a child there in Belize, but you know, Jesus is great, and Mary and all, and I don't mean any disrespect, but I think from a very young age, I could distinguish an image from spirit. Mm. And so that's why, for me, the word spirit has a very deep meaning. And the spirit then is in the space. Like if we get still or we listen to certain music and we drop in, we'll feel spirit right here, right? Like, we'll bring spirit forward. So for me, the word is spirit. The word divine really has become more fluent to me only maybe in the last 10 years. And the way it shows up for me is in myself, not outside of me. And that divinity is something of truth, of kindness, of understanding what else is here in this body and mind. That's beyond the stories and the socialization of what I'm supposed to be. The healing that has allowed me to see that there's divinity in me, that's where I've touched the divine. So thank you.
I grew up very embedded in church. I'm a PK, a pastor's kid, and only child of two ordained ministers, so I grew up very embedded in the church. And this question is interesting for me because I feel like I was born and raised in Puerto Rico, and it was very common for me to see iconography and imagery that depicted Jesus as white. And so in terms of the art, I knew that when it was depicted that way, it was meant to signify Jesus. However, the churches that I went to, that wasn't the case. And we grew up doing a lot of like plays and things like that in church. And always my friends who represented Jesus were never white. And so as I was thinking of this question, I was like, well, the iconography told me that Jesus was white, but then my experience within the church told me otherwise. And in my particular experience as well, my mom became a pastor before my dad did. And so in this sort of telling that pastors are like representatives of God and the voice of God, every Sunday when I went to church, there was a woman that looked like me in the pulpit. And so that was my image of the Word of God was my mom, but it was also a woman that was standing, that was defying the conventions even of Puerto Rico, of the church who has all of this things around women in ministry. And so I feel like that from a young age, even if I wasn't aware of it, was creating these questions in me. And then
around seventh grade, I believe, I was enrolled in La Escuela Libre de Música de Puerto Rico, it's a music school, as a percussionist. And so there, I started learning all of this history and tradition of percussion that started pushing a lot of these more these questions more and more. So it was like, where is this coming from? Like, why are these conventions? Why do we practice this culturally? And so I feel like that was a moment that not only allowed me, but forced me to go back to think about my experience and to interpret it as I was acquiring more language and to say categorically, like, what does it mean for me to be Christian and see Jesus that way or perceive God that way? What does it mean for my practice? What does it mean for what I do? And then as I gain more academic language, it's gained like more and more, but I think it builds on that experience of when I was little. It builds on seeing a woman that looked like me in the pulpit and that being my understanding of how God was speaking through me or to me.
I would say bringing it back to Catholicism, I was raised Catholic. Both of my parents are Catholic. My mom's African-American and her family is actually not really Catholic. But at the time, in order to attend Catholic school, you had to convert to Catholicism. So my grandmother, my mom, and my aunt are all Catholic. We definitely recognized the difference when we went to church services with the rest of my family in New York. We're like, this is grape juice, you know, like it's a little bit different. And my dad is Panamanian, he's also Catholic. I consider myself culturally Catholic now more than anything else. But when I was reading this question, and this is not something really that I think about so much academically, but with Teddy being my colleague and my hallmate for a long time, this is stuff that we've talked about. And so I grew up, the church that I grew up in, really, was mostly African-American Caribbean people. So it very much, I saw people who looked like me in the Catholic faith every day. Our priest was black. The iconography was white Jesus, right? So I recognize that. But what is so interesting, because I also grew up in a very pro-black house, right? Like blackness as diasporic, like I said, my dad's Panamanian, my mom's African-American. But I also grew up with a lot of Virgin Marys in my room, my sister and I, like a lot of Virgin Mary statues, like, you know, like this 4-foot statue. And Mary was white, and it never, like it was not something that I thought about really, about how it wasn't just these things in an external space in this church, but actually in our home, the way these things looked. And it didn't, there was never for me the idea that this is what Jesus looks like, or this is what Mary looks like, despite, right, like seeing her before I went to sleep every night. But I think I just have always dismissed that as this is somebody's representation. And I don't think I actually have a visual of like that's just not how, too many says, that's just not how I experience spirit or divine. Like I don't necessarily imagine anything in any kind of physical form. But I will say that going to feast day, the celebration day, October 21st of El Cristo Negro de Puerto Velo in Panama, which was shown a little bit here too, it just, I'd seen El Cristo Negro before, but never with, you know, 50,000 other people. And it was just such a moving experience. And I was like, what would it have been like for me to have grown up with a Christ to look like this? You know, and even though for me, spirit and divine is always in community with other black people, it really did, there was like this dissonance, right? This separation that had to happen between like what other people are projecting on me as this is what Jesus, this is what God, this is what Mary looks like. And then also Marianismo and finding out like the Virgin Mary can look like a whole bunch of different things, depending on where you are. I think that just shot it all away. Like, oh, this isn't even what Mary looks like, you know, according to people here, according to people here. And so I do think that there's mental gymnastics that a lot of us make depending on, you know, where you grow up and how your church is oriented, even if the parishioners are black, that doesn't necessarily mean that the images that we are shown or that we are given match up with what we know to be true.
Yeah. Well, this is such a great, thank you all. I think, you know, that's such a good question, and it gives me a chance to quote Octavia Butler. So Octavia Butler wrote a book, a short story called The Book of Martha, which is a really beautiful short story where the character Martha progressively first encounters God. I'm not going to give away the whole plot, so you read the short story. But she encounters God, and when she encounters God, she first encounters God as a white male with beard thing. It's described as white beard, white male. And she asks, like, God, she's like, why am I seeing you like that? God is like, you see me the way you need to see me at this time. And progressively, her image of God changes to an image of God that looks like her. And it ends with a God that looks just like her. She's like, and God now looks like me. And the reason why I love the Book of Martha, and that's your story, and I love that because I do think that that's our journey. I think that oftentimes this unlearning and relearning that we have to do is unlearning that when we really say that the image of God, that we are made in the image of God, that God then doesn't have one image. But culturally, we're hit with that so much, like white God, white Jesus, white God, white Jesus, white Mary, white God. It's so all over. So it does take a lot of intentionality to unlearn that. I remember early on, my father, who my dear friends allowed me to also dedicate this film to, so who passed away a few years ago, so that's a really big honor. He was a very visibly black man, a pastor, who walked around in spaces where he was very, very, very prejudiced and experienced extreme racism in Colombia and in the U.S. My sister and I would always remember stories that, like, he would literally, like, stop a cab in the middle of the road, like, we're getting out of this cab because the guy was racist. He would say something anti-black. So, but learning his love for theology started to give me an understanding that God didn't necessarily look like what I'm hearing. So really young, I remember thinking that. And I remember for some reason, and you remember like the book fairs in school, I remember for some reason buying, like, you know, everyone gets like a Where's Waldo book or whatever little book you get. I bought a book by Ivan van Sertum on Black Before Columbus. Why? I don't really know why. But now, you know, and another person we dedicated the film to, Michael Charles and I dedicated the film to, our teacher, our ancestor, our second mother in many ways, Miriam Jimenez Roman and Juan Flores, who were really thankful for, you know, really, she always told me, she's like, you have this burgeoning blackness understanding. That's why you bought that book at 12. Like, what 12-year-old is buying Black Before Columbus by Ivan van Sertum? No one is buying that book. But that's what I bought. And that started to change. And I think from then I started to be like, God looks differently. And it conceptualized for me. And that's why I identify a lot with the character of Martha by Octavia Butler in that story. Because then little by little, the use of the white image of God was no longer useful for me. Mm-hmm. It doesn't mean anything to me. It actually belittles God. I actually think, like, if we think that God is so narrow to only be represented in one type of phenotype, that's really narrow-mindedness of the divine. So now I see God as many different things. And I think just more lately, I've just been embracing just the different ways in which God is communicated to people in Sikh tradition. I'm not Sikh, I'm Christian, but in Sikh tradition, they say that Sikhs say God gives God's name to everyone individually. So like the name that God has, you know God's name for yourself. And I think that's kind of the way that the image of God is for us. I think that we have individual images of God, which I think is actually a more powerful thing. And I've been thankful for over the course of my life to be able to see God as a black woman, as a black man, as a trans non-conforming, you know, as many different things, because I don't think that my image of God is limited to a binary, because I don't think God is limited to things. I think actually limiting God to a specific box is actually really constricting, where God is so grand. And so for me, that has served many of those purposes. And I think just like the character of Martha, as we go on in our life, the usefulness of the white image of God for those of us who are non-white, because for those of us who identify as white, maybe that is an image that we serve. But for those of us who are non-white, eventually we should get to a point where God looks like us and God resembles us.
Can I jump in that? It's funny that you say that, because I was thinking about Ariana's comment that there is this quote, and I can't remember the book right now, but about El Cristo Chero, who is a black Christ as well. And it's this story about this statue that was made of wood, right? And it was a light wood, but they would light candles in front of it. And so candles are lit when they pray. So the more that they prayed to this Christ, the darker this Christ would become. And so eventually, I think that's a really image, a powerful image to think about what you're saying and kind of piggybacking on what you said, Ariana, is that it's also how the divine transforms into the more that we pray or the more that we think about it, the more that we recognize the divine in ourselves and everything like that, the blacker this Christ becomes or becomes what we need this Christ to become. And so I think it's really powerful to think it in that way, to think it as a journey, that as we establish in that relationship, what was said in the film, this faith that is just one-on-one, that image becomes more closer and closer to us.
Absolutely, absolutely. Ariana, I want to follow back up with you for this next question, and the next two really pigging it back. You've ushered us in, y'all. So we're in it, you all. And get your questions. If you're thinking about questions, get prepared. We're going to open up the floor real soon for your questions. But Ariana, Yvette talks about the importance of how one sees themselves in relationship to how one is viewed by the larger society. Why is it important to talk about identity and identification for Afro-Latinx communities?
I know, I'll try to be brief. This is like literally what I do. And shout out to my fellow Panameña, Yvette Modestine. So I think what she brings up beautifully, and I was glad to see it in this version, is that when we talk about identity and identification, there is how you believe yourself and how you call yourself. But our identity and identification is not only self-made, right? It's always in relationship to how other people call us and how other people see us and how other people understand or misunderstand us. And so I think particularly for Afro-Latine communities and Afro-Latine identities, and communities plural, as we've talked about, right? There's not just a singular Afro-Latinidad, but there is how Blackness is understood in the United States, right, where we are. There's how Blackness has been erased in Latin America. And then there's just visual representations of Latinidad. So first, you know, the visual representations of Latinidad in the United States have been an off-white, mm-hmm. right? It has denied Blackness, period.
Yep.
I appreciated the numbers. You know, I'm a qualitative person, but we need to know that 90%, right, of kidnapped Africans from the continent of Africa were brought to Latin America and the Caribbean. Mm-hmm. So Afro-Latinidad is nothing new. We are centuries deep in these spaces. And these are projects of denial and erasure that have led people to believe that there are not Black people there. Mm-hmm. There are Black people there who know they are Black and have called themselves Black for centuries.
Yep.
And so what I appreciate about this film, though, is that it presents that story, but also the story of people who are finding their Blackness or are newly articulating their Blackness. Both of those things are important, but neither one of those things define the community, yeah. right? So when we hear about like, oh, people didn't know they were Black, they did, they do, and we are.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so there's that. And then there's just the general erasure of Blackness from Latinidad, not theoretically, right? Because Latinidad is based on this notion of mixture.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, who are you mixing with then if there are no Black people? But there's this idea of dilution of Blackness, and then this denial of the persistence of Black people, right? Not just Blackness as cultural elements like music or food or religion, but actual Black people, right? Because then that's a conversation about rights.
Mm-hmm.
So I think all of those things are important. And especially, you know, for me working in this space, right, where African American is the dominant identity, but too often, not necessarily here or not necessarily us, but we know that people use Black as a synonym for African American and they're not synonyms. Right, all African-American people are Black, not all Black people are African-American.
Mm-hmm.
So as we became more precise with our language, moving from Negro to Black, those were everybody. African-American is not everybody, but people articulating an Afro-Latina identity is not a denial of Blackness, right? It's just a specificity of it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, we acknowledge that Blackness is not homogenous. And so I think for Afro-Latina, Afro-Latin American communities, we have always known that we are Black. We have maintained our Blackness. We've said it for generations. And now this identity and identification part is that other people recognize what that is,
mm-hmm.
right? So we can use these terms, and then they're now more publicly understood yeah. than they were generations ago. And so again, like, it's that Afro-Latinidad is not new. It's just that other people now understand what that means when we say it.
Mm-hmm.
And with that larger public understanding, I think one of the things I appreciate about this film is that it's still important that we are the authors of our stories in that way.
Mm-hmm.
Right, if we're using these terminologies to reference a particular people, then it's still up to us to make sure we're kind of controlling not the narrative of what that means, right, but the authorship of what that looks like.
Mm-hmm.
And so I love this, and I love that Yvette said it so plainly in that way for people to really think about, like, I've always known who I am, but now you know who I am.
Exactly.
And now we can be in conversation.
Yeah.
Can I add something to that real quick? That's Ariana. I remember having a conversation with someone about that, and they were like, well, when does the Afro-Latino term become a thing? And I was like, Afro-Latinos have been around. Like, what do you mean? And he was like, well, I need a date. And I was like, I'm not going to give you a date. And what I did was I quoted to him Frantz Fanon, who in Wretched of the Earth says, the fact of Blackness is the lived experience of the Black person. And the lived experience of Black people in Latin America goes deep.
Yeah.
And I remember saying, and when he was fighting, like, we had an argument. And my friends and people who know me know I'm always down for an argument. But I was like, There's no date. I'm not going to give you a date because we've been part of the history forever. So you can't have any aspect of what we consider Latinx culture, to use a general term, without blackness. Like, all of the parts that people celebrate about Latinx culture is black. So I'm like, all of that is black. So what I said is, so he was like, well, we need a date. I said, well, I'm not going to give you a date. What I'm going to tell you is that that history has been along at the continent for a while. There's a process of erasure. I'm Colombian. The first president of Colombia, of the free black Colombian, and my Afro-Colombians who are here know that, is a black man named Juan José Neto Gil. He's a black man who was literally visually erased to look white because he looked more like me. And they were like, we're going to whiten him because we don't want people to know that he's black. So there's a process of white supremacy and erasure that's happened throughout the continent that has let people not understand that there's a lived experience of black people forever in Latin America and the Caribbean and for people who are Latinx. So therefore, they understand. But there was process of reclaiming, right? Arturo Schomburg, who we give a visual shout out to, did that because he was told black people have no history. He was like, I'm going to show you wrong. And the profundity of Schomburg's research is still just being understood as a black body. He was the first person who probably used Afro hyphen something. He called himself Afro Boricua. But his research was, I just found out he did research on black people in Spain and Portugal.
The Juan de Pareja.
Yes, and all of that. And we give a visual shout out to Juan de Pareja. But it's, it takes a lot of intentionality. And just like it took, like when Michael found that footage of archival of black Puerto Ricans in Cuba, that was embedded in this video of white history that you have to then, you know, sift through the white history to find the black history.
Yep.
But then once you find it, it's like, let's pull it out. Mm-hmm. Let's show you that we've been here since all that time. And I think that takes a lot of intentionality. So thank you for saying that.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. Thank you. Yes.
Can I jump in?
Yeah, go ahead.
This also, so I agree we don't need the date. However, the way the external naming does help us navigate our own development is really important. And I say that because when I first migrated to this country in the late 70s, in Belize, everybody's Creole, right? Criollo. But we don't say Criollo because we're... our dialect is Afro-descendant dialect, so it's not French-descendant dialect. So everybody's Creole, right? So I grew up until coming to this country, I'm Creole, right? Then I come to this country, and then you have to check the boxes. I couldn't find myself in this country, right? So there was an erasure of me. I was like, where, what am I? Right? And a lot of us who immigrate to this country, we struggle with this. It wasn't until, I don't remember the year either, but I'm going to say I was glad to see that pop up. Right? Because without the label, the external, the question about how important it is. So I would write Creole on the papers, you know, school admission stuff, et cetera. I would write Creole, I'd put other. So when you don't have that label and you're having to, again, other yourself, you don't belong here. Mm-hmm. That's something about this country, right, that we're slowly moving into. The specificity of all of us need to be acknowledged because it does something to a young child, not being able to even identify as to who you are, right? So it's really critical, actually, I think, that we really start to understand the fullness of everybody and who's here, especially when you leave a country and you come and you migrate here, and you come here with this understanding of who you are, and then you land here and you're like, who the heck am I? I want to go home because you're not seen here. Mm. So there's this Afro-Latin name. I have to say, it's like, for me, when I saw it the first time, I was like, oh, it was like a breath out. Even though I never gave up my identity as Creole, and that's still my identity, but here in this country, you know, now I feel like I'm acknowledged as part of it. Mm. And I know it's not fully acknowledged, but at least it's like moving toward that.
Mm. Not to belabor the point. Do we got time? Can I comment on this? So I've just been processing a lot because I just recently came back from a civil rights tour through the Deep South, and a lot of these conversations were being had over the course of this past week. And I think to your question about the importance of identity for Afro-Latine people, it's particularly important in terms of how we relate to our African-American brothers and sisters, because there are a lot of conversations being had right now about, you know, what is black? You know, I think we don't want to be inclusive to the extent of being exclusive. And then also, we want to make sure that we embrace the diaspora in terms of our terminology as well. And I think that Afro-Latines are particularly spearheading those conversations, because white supremacy and the Western European mindset as it exists here in British North America has created a binary. And so these ethnic subgroups are not recognized, but it's important. You know, when we were in New Orleans and Louisiana, you know, the sister here mentioned Creole, there's like a whole nother dynamic going on down there that's not really, those conversations aren't really being had in the Mid-South or the upper, you know, or up north. You have black Creoles, white Creoles, you got all this whole other dynamic because of their French, Spanish, and Caribbean infusion. It's like, you know, that's an interesting dynamic that I think as Afro-Latinos continue to relocate to this country and, you know, awaken to the form of oppression and white supremacy as it exists here, that those conversations are going to be, you know, more and more important, because there is direct connections that can be made between our communities, and it doesn't have to be any fighting between us. You know, we should be able to embrace one another as we are.
This is going to be my last question before we open it up to anyone here. If you have a question, we're going to ask that you go to stand in the back. There's a mic there. They're going to lift it up for you. So if you have a question, we urge you to go back there. I will give this disclaimer. We're going to ask that you please ask a question. Look, as a former pastor, amen, ask a question. All right, because we know we have all of that with us, and all the beauty and the all of that. We're just going to ask that you please ask a question. Okay, so if you're not asking a question, I'm going to do the little church finger, and that gives you the message that we need a question. Okay, but I do want to point this question at three people, and then I really want to open it up for everyone. Yahusef, Marisela, and Ariana, but please, everyone, feel free to jump in. Why is it important for individuals to see themselves in the divine or spirit? What are the sociological, anthropological, and theological ramifications when whiteness is the norm? How does one begin the work of decolonization, especially as it relates to their faith and spirituality? Really thinking about those who are here in person and those who are watching online. How do one begin that work of decolonization?
That's a complex question. I think we're seeing the ramifications of what centering whiteness does anthropologically, theologically, sociologically. You know, I think we've seen that for generations, and us having sort of an inherent, I'm speaking in generals, of course. I know some people are in different areas on the spectrum, but having sort of a devalued sense of self and having to awaken to the fact that, you know, no, there is more. And you know, I don't know if we can measure the impacts of that, because that places stress, you know, that places questioning one's identity, you know, having sort of this ambiguous, you know, lens of where you belong, and there are real ramifications to that. As far as, you know, doing the work of decolonizing one's faith, you know, the truth will set you free. And I think that the truth is on our side as a people, because we're an ancient people. And we've existed before this, you know, system of white supremacy as we know it, we've existed long before colonialization. And so I think when one is ready to embrace that journey and, you know, go on the path of truth, that you know, you got to take what comes with that and be ready to receive what you encounter. And I think that that's the most honest and pure way of decolonizing one's faith, because, as I said, I believe that the truth, you know, it does lie on our side, and as we speak about cultural, ethnic, you know, distinctions and things like that. But yeah, it's complex. I think everybody's journey is different, but I'm just speaking for myself. That's what you know, empowered me as a young man navigating through this society was a genuine desire to know the truth, and then just going wherever that has taken me.
Great question. I think we're living the effect of not divining ourselves now. The journey, the sociological outcome, the theological, the anthropological, all of that. We're living that now, right? We're living it in the hood, where Black brothers and sisters are responding to, you know, small differences with guns, right? So we're actually, if we saw ourselves as divine, we would find that we had more in us in how we engage with each other, same or different. So this referencing to whiteness, you know, non-white. So one of the things I've been doing for many years is turning it around. Everything for me, it's non-Black. And just that little thing just shifts the whole way that the world spins, right? So now it's a reference to Blackness and everything else from there. But we even have to go beyond that. But that's the journey is in this movement of the decolonization is really taking it back, and in so doing, we will see what comes from that. And then the next stage, and maybe I won't be around for that stage, there'll be a next stage where it doesn't need to be non-Black. But right now, because everything's been non-white, so it's white and everything's referenced to that, that has to get completely taken apart, dismantled. And so then the non-Black, now it says, okay, now let's reference this. Ah, like, what does that mean? Wow, let me rethink that. Like, put that into my little box and the way I've been thinking of the world and think about that. And then it, like, conjures up all this stuff, right? To me, this is the work of divination. because when I do that now, I don't have to situate myself relative to whiteness anymore. It, like, opens up so I can see beyond. I go beyond non-Black. And that's, for me, is the divine, because all of a sudden, it's whoever I am is enough. And the socialization has been unlearning that, the belief that I'm not enough because of what this body looks like, what this hair is, what this mountain teat is, right? That's what I've been told, is there is no divine here. And now I know that everything is the divine, and it starts right here in me. Now, once I realize that, my divinity, I can now see the divinity in every single one of you. Mm. And in our tradition, we bow a lot. And when we bow, it's not bowing to something that we prostrate or think is greater. When we bow, it says, the divinity in me sees the divinity in you. And to be able to see that requires me to be able to see the divinity in me first. Once I see that, then I can see in every single one of you. So for me, that's the journey. Yeah.
No, I think that's a beautiful end note. I don't have anything to add to that.
So we're going to open up for questions. If you have a question at this time, we invite you to come to the mic. If you could just give your name and your question. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Angelique Nelson, and my question is, because I wrote a book about genealogy for kids, and in it there's a whole section about the Afro-Latine, the black populations in the African diaspora, so there's a whole section in there about that. And there's also a section about Afro-Caribbean religions because of what you said about, you know, the misinformation. So my question is, does the practice of Afro-Latine religions kind of lend itself to families, and I realize that, you know, this is a very general question, does it lend itself to people or families knowing their genealogy, family or family history, because of that emphasis on the ancestors, if that makes sense?
I think it does, and the way that I think it does is that I think one of the importances of conversations like this is that when we talk about this conversation of blackness and of Afro-Latina identity, we also not only do it in reference of the conception of race in the United States, but also the ways in which race is conceptualized in continental Latin American and the Caribbean, because there's also the danger of a lot of Caribbean, Latin American conceptions of race still operate in the casta system of Spain, where like blackness is in degrees, and there's this like tendency to be like, oh, tú eres negro. No, yo soy café con leche. Right? And so I think adding this perspective, right, and centering this conversation in relation to faith and religious tradition, which tends to be really important for the Latinx community, whether they profess it and practice it constantly or not, I think lends itself to then starting on this journey of discovery and understanding, like, where do we come from? Where does my conception of race come from? What is the language that was said to me that led me to understand myself in this way? Who are the people in my family stories that are talked about a lot? And who are the people that are not being mentioned? And then suddenly, randomly, and like, ¿cómo se dice? Like, que se te sale así de la lengua, suddenly they're talking about somebody que le decían el mulo or something because he was real black and nobody ever told you. And then you're like, oh, wait, so there's somebody here who is being intentionally erased and who's not. And I think faith and talking about the Afro-Latinx identity in relation to that can, I don't want to use force because it sounds really violent, but can sort of usher in the necessity for that conversation. Because again, it goes then to the image of the divine, right? And how the image of the divine influence us, and in particular for Christianity, the doctrine of the Imago Dei, saying that we are all made, and you know, imagen y semejanza, in God's likeness, then this conversation is saying that if God is white, there's something lesser in me because I'm not fully at the image of the divine. And so, like, adding all of this, I think, lends itself to then starting that journey of discovery and of genealogy for sure.
And real quick, also, I think just that is part of the process of reclaiming our stories and reclaiming. I think that the more that we search, and Yahusef's story does that in the documentary, but this is a thing that the more you search, the more that you find out. And so the more that you start to really embrace and understand, you have to go there. I can't remember the writer right now, I was thinking about it, but it's this gentleman who wrote a book on the history of black institutions in Brooklyn. And he says that a lot of black institutions in Brooklyn specifically choose the name Africa as a location because we're gonna point to the thing and we're gonna find how we were there. Africa becomes a reference point in the genealogy, right? So it's a part of undoing that sort of white understanding and white gaze that you have to do that. So I wouldn't say that you can't practice an Afro-descendant tradition without being Afro-descendant. But I think it just leads you to that search. Like, you just have to find it eventually because it's just a natural pathway to that.
I just wanted to add one other small framework point, just that when we talk about African-American, Afro-Latina, Afro-Caribbean, I think we just also have to understand and put language to African-Americans are part of the African diaspora. It's not that the diaspora is all of the other black people in this hemisphere, excluding African-Americans. And so I think if we start to think of ourselves as diasporic people, as part of this continuum of the African diaspora, then these political boundaries, they're still important, but become a little bit less important when you're talking about things that transcend boundaries.
Yes.
Thank you. The movie was very, very, very moving. So Altagracia Perez Bullard. First, can I get your paper? Like, and then the question is, I'm working on a paper, and I wonder what you all think about the way that Afro-Latina youth are blending religious traditions and the challenge that that is for more traditional religions like Christianity or Islam or Judaism. So I just wonder what y'all think about that.
I just texted you about this. So yes, I can give you my paper. You can also go to AfroLatinetheology.com, and it's also there. We put it there. And there's other writings by other people, too, because the idea of the Afro-Latinx Theology Project is to highlight these different stories by different faith traditions who are talking religious. So real quickly on that question, I actually was just reading The Black Scholar, and they had an issue on black digital religions in the U.S. And in that issue on black digital religions in the U.S., it's really interesting because they talk about the digitizing and technology and the use of social media as creating new religious spaces, and how that is upending kind of what people think traditional religion is. But I think that let's take a few, zoom out a little bit, and what is the purpose of religion and spirituality, then what people are doing is not really something, that's what I was saying, it's not something really only ingenuous now, it's something that's different now, but that has been done in diaspora for a long time. The diaspora has had people who have blended traditions. The tradition in Louisiana, I know you're going to Louisiana right after this, there's a tradition called Easter Rock, which is one of the last remaining traditions in which African, French kind of African spirituality, African spirituality is blended with French spirituality, is blended with Christianity, is really unique. That's a really unique blend. It's one of the few places that practices that. I think what I would say young people are doing, and I said this to Yolanda because we was like, I think this is what we're doing with the podcast and with the theology project, is we're creating spaces where people can see themselves. And I think that the reason why people are redefining those spaces is like, oh, I don't see myself in your traditional regular church, so I'm going to create my own thing. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to make it with this. And you know what? I'm going to create John Coltrane as a saint, for example. The John Coltrane Church is an example of that. Mm-hmm. Venerating Coltrane as a saint that guides people into the divine. That church started in the 60s and has been around for 50 years, for more than 50 years. And so I think that that's something that's, yes, new and happens, but I think it's because people want to see themselves and who is it that ushers the divine. Yeah. And I think that that's why those spaces are important, because we have had to be like, okay, if you don't want me to tell, if the divine for you continues to be this white image of Jesus, I'm telling you that's not who the divine is, then fine, I'm not going to be there. I'm going to go and make my own thing where the divine is going to be what I think the divine is.
And if I could jump really quickly, I also like to point out that this is not something that Afro-Latina youth are doing now. I think they're calling out the ways in which older generations did it, but didn't want to talk about it. Because you were having a lot of Christians yéndose a santiguarse con la santera, right? And they were like, oh no, because that's a cultural practice, so it's not in opposition to my Christian faith. So I think it's also what Afro-Latina youth are doing now is calling out the ways in which we were doing this before, but we didn't want to recognize that as part of our tradition, and sort of putting down these frameworks that come from outside to say, no, we've always done this. Let's talk about how we've done it, and let's name it as something that can coexist, that not doesn't need to be something that I do like escondido so nobody can see me and tell me que me voy a ir para el infierno, right? It's like we can coexist in that, and so I think more than anything, more than creating something new, they're also just naming what has been there generationally and exposing it to be like, this has always happened. Now let's let people know that this is how we move in the world.
Thank you. So we have two final questions. What I'm going to ask you to do is to please just state your question. Both of you, I think I see one other person. State your question, and then we're going to allow people. These will be our last two questions. Thanks.
Quickly, in terms of, can you speak to the bravery that's necessary to talk about various faiths in one space and when it's typically hasn't been a place to talk about things inclusively when you're talking about faith and for, you know, at one time. It's, you know, one or the other, you have to choose. There's not really an openness in regards to discussing different faiths all in one space, and that being welcomed, if I can say that.
So, amazing job. I feel like this documentary feels like it was the start of a conversation, and I'm looking at this title, and it feels like it's the beginning of a sentence. So I'm curious to know if you can complete the sentence. Faith in Blackness is faith. I have faith in Blackness to seek the truth. I have faith in Blackness will always find ourselves despite being erased. How would you finish that sentence? What do you have faith about our Blackness in particular? And I'm not certain if that's how you guys designed it, but that's how it felt.
Okay. And do I see, okay, all right. So I'm gonna allow you all jump into that question, or both questions as you see fit.
Yeah.
I mean, I feel like you guys should talk about representing different traditions in one
space. Oh yeah, that's right. I think that was Asmaret. I can't see that well from here. There's a lot of lights in front. But hey, Asmaret. A coworker of mine, a good friend. I think it was, you know, it was really important for us to have the religions in conversation with one another. We didn't want any one religion to be more highlighted than another. Actually, that was really painstaking work. The three of us we literally would edit from 11 in the morning to 3 in the morning the next day, like, oh man, how are we gonna show the equality? Now, I remember Michael and Charles in this process being like, we gotta do this, we gotta do that. We would be angry at each other because we wanted to highlight something, but then we did that. But we wanted to do that because we don't think that number one, we didn't wanna show any religion as being like the bad religion. We only referenced that in Catholicism a little bit because everyone had mentioned that we had to do it. Like, everyone referenced something about Catholicism being kind of a little oppressive. But we didn't even want to do that, actually, because we wanted to make sure that every tradition has beauty and all that. And we thought that that would be bravery, and we thought about it a lot. We were like, how is this community going to feel when we're putting them next to this? How are they going to feel when we go here to here? But what we then landed on as a team is, you know what, we're showing that these traditions exist together in the world. And people practice these traditions, and people practice hybrid of those traditions. Yvette Modestine is Ifa, an Ifa practitioner, which is an African descendant religion, and a Catholic. She's Catholic. She says, I'm both. She's equally both. And she wanted to make sure that people understood. It's not like she left one. She embraces both. And that for us then became, like, actually Yvette telling us that, I remember, was like, that's what we're going to do. All of the religions need to exist. All the traditions need to exist together. And we're not going to worry so much if one's going to be angry, but we're just going to highlight them all. And if some of them are angry, we'll talk to them about it. And be like, we'll tell you why. But that was part of the purpose. And then I would say, you know, for the last question, I think that was Cassie. faith in Blackness for me is equal to love. I think one of our guiding words and practices while we were creating this film together was love. The love of Blackness, love of Black people, embracing of the love of our roots. And understanding, like Jose says in the documentary, Jose Humphreys is a dear friend, pastor in Harlem, where he says that we also stand in Blackness is not a reference point, but it stands on its own in the ecology of beauty and grace. That, for me, is what faith in Blackness is.
Are we just going down? Okay. I think to the first question, there is a bravery and we also recognize that it's, even if it was hard, it's easier to do this way than to try to take it back to some of the communities that are represented here. And so I think there is that recognition of the pain that I think it's one of the things that also is in the documentary that, you know, some of the churches that I know, I wouldn't be able to bring some of these ideas to because they would be like, you got a little crazy. You need to like go back. So I think, yeah, it does take bravery, and it does take this sort of process of really thinking through decisions that are made, conversations that are going to be had, topics, how they're going to be brought in. But I don't think it's impossible. And I think it requires for us to really truly start, because if we come from this point of view of like, you know, they're going to disagree and it's going to be like, we're never going to get anywhere. And so I think it's also a matter of accountability, of holding traditions accountable or holding our community accountable and saying, hey, we're all existing here with all of these different traditions, all these different understandings. When are we truly going to talk about what that means, right? And how that enriches, right, this experience and these identities. And I think to the second question, I can't help but think, I've been reading Cole Arthur Riley's This Here Flesh, who is the curator of Black Liturgies. Look her up on Instagram, she's amazing. And when I bought the book, I actually got to hear her speak, and she dedicated the book and say, Yolanda, stay in your body, Cole Arthur Riley, and that was it. So for me, faith in Blackness is staying in your body. It is understanding how you believe, whether that is an organized religion and tradition or just your own mix of it, that you're here, right? That you're in house in this, and that this is also part of it. It's understanding everything through the lens of how you move in the world and how it moves in you. It is dancing bomba, it is palo, it is all of these music and movement that takes your body to this experience of the divine, where sometimes you don't have the language, but it's there. And so I feel like if it could be summarized to me, faith in Blackness is staying in your body and living in it.
Faith in Blackness that yeah, I don't know. It's it felt enough for me. Just this faith in Blackness. Because there's so much there. I mean, I feel like if I chose one thing, I would leave others. So I'm gonna leave it there. It's enough for me. And I celebrate the way that it invites in more. And I want to share one of the reasons that I started practicing in the Buddhist tradition, coming out of a very strong Catholic tradition, is that the altar that I saw in a monastery didn't have a Buddha on it. It had flowers. And I thought, isn't that something? So this question around the courage and how do we actually bring the different traditions together, that the idea that the divine is everywhere, is in nature, is a beautiful sunset, it's a child's smile, it's the smell of a rose or something like that. I think for me, that's what bringing the different traditions and spiritualities together is, being able to let go of what the iconic historical image might be in the popular spaces, and really remember why we're even doing any spirituality in the first place. And then if we can really touch on that, then it feels like it would lead us into the places that we could really be together with each other. I know it's kind of vague, and yeah, thank you.
So the first question, you used the term brave. I think that that's absolutely right, but I also think that that's not a foreign concept to us. I think bravery has been something that we have exemplified since, we're talking about, you know, Africans coming on this side, you know, since the Ma'afa, the Middle Passage, you know, when the slave masters told us that we couldn't worship in our authentic form and we would sneak off and go pray out loud or go do these things anyways or sing songs that reconnected us to our traditions. I think that that was bravery. And, you know, all the way up to the present, you know, everything that we've been that we've had to do has been an act of bravery. So I'm not too shy or discouraged to have a conversation. You know, I think that it's important, and I think it's important that we continue to be brave so that we can explore, you know, new ideals and understanding about what all this means to us, because, you know, our history has been stripped from us, and so it's important to reclaim those things and in an authentic way, you know, to ourselves. So with that, I'll say that faith in Blackness is needed, is necessary.
All right, I'll round us out here. I just want to say, in terms of bravery and bringing this space together, I want to just thank my colleagues at the Center for the Study of African American Religious Life. Because being at a National Museum of African American History and Culture, having a center that studies African American religious life, this is not necessarily what people think of, right? But they recognize this as necessary conversations. And it's not without public backlash. And so I want to, you know, just really thank them for their bravery, for saying, despite the fact that other people may not believe that this is what African American religious life can look like, it is. You know, and I would like to just highlight that this is not just what we talk about, it is actually shown in our collections. You know, this is actually the work that we do here. And I'm glad to see you guys all here to be able to experience this film. Thank you all for being here and being able to share your wisdom with all of us. And so just as a final thought for me, I mean, for me, my faith in Blackness is just unwavering, I would say. You know, when I am around other Black people, I always know I'm gonna be fine, no matter what the context, no matter what the situation. So thank you for that.
Can we give all of our panelists a round of applause? We want to thank all of you for coming. If you have a friend that was unable to make it, this conversation is online, so you can go to the museum's website or our YouTube page. The film is not there, but you can definitely stream the conversation that was had. We also encourage you to head out to the mall if you're here to check out the Folklife Festival, which is the whole theme is around world religion, so we encourage you to take part in what's going on the mall and throughout DC throughout this weekend. Again, it's stay in tune with what's going on here at the museum. Check out the website. We have programs and things going on all throughout the year. Again, thank you all for this film. Thank you for the work that you put into it. Thank you for your willingness to be in this space. Until we meet again, have a good rest of your day. Bien, soy bellaquito y tú eres provocación. Who's back? Amárrame a tu espalda, yo me presto. En tu escuelita dame clase de placer.